Hey everybody, this is Becky Leggero here today with Fiona Ewens-Brown, the Chief HR Officer of Catena Media. And we have so much going on right now, especially in the land of HR, managing working remote situations, managing employees that are going through this global pandemic. It's absolutely unbelievable, and you are right there on the front lines with the company to make sure everybody's doing okay. So this is what we're here to talk about today, Fiona, to share some of your best practices with our audience. So thank you so much for joining me.
No problem.
Yeah, we're gonna kick off with the biggest topic here of conversation with HR, especially, which is working from home. Everyone, apart from several places such as Sweden, they're required to work from home at the moment. Some companies were set up for this, some were not. So can you tell us what the situation is in terms of Catena Media and some of the positives and the negatives from your perspective of working from home?
Yeah, sure. It's been really interesting times, to say the least. So we have offices around the world in a few different locations, and so each country has been a little bit different in terms of obviously how the local governments have actually been handling things. So we've needed to follow a little bit of their guidelines. The first office that we had that started working from home was our Italian office. They're based in Rome. Obviously, that happened now, you know, kind of very, very early on. Italy was impacted very quickly. So that was an easy decision to make, that they all started working from home. As a company, we are lucky that we're in a situation where we were able to make a decision in all of the locations, pretty much from one minute to the next, that people could work from home. We had the tech set up and we have the capabilities that we can do everything remotely. So that really helped us. And I know, you know, kind of for a lot of gaming operators that have custom service teams or, you know, live studios or any of those types of things, and that was a bit more of a challenge. But as an affiliate, we didn't have that problem. So as I said, so Italy were the first ones to start working from home. Then very, very quickly after that, Serbia and obviously Tokyo was impacted as well, and Malta. And then the UK was kind of one of our last offices to be impacted. And as you say, Sweden, we only have a very small office in Stockholm. And they've been a little bit more flexible with some of them still going into the office. With Malta is our largest. We did make the decision to completely shut down and lock down the whole office. So we actually banned access, which I know is something that's a little bit different to what some of the other companies did. And the main reason for us doing that was we wanted people to stay working from home, and we wanted them to be safe. And the best way for us to be able to do that was to ensure that they weren't coming into the office. And it then meant that also then, you know, the office is closed, locked down, safe and secure, and we just don't need to worry about, you know, how many people are in, you know, so any social distancing or any of those types of situations. So it's now been, you know, kind of 8 weeks or more for kind of most of the offices. And interestingly, on the positive side of things, we have seen increased engagement. We've seen increases in the collaboration, and therefore, obviously, both of those have a direct impact on productivity. And we're seeing some fantastic results. That even with, you know, our sports business being really hit with no events, that we're still managing to do really well when it comes to our revenues and everything else at the moment as well. So that's been a real positive, and people are really pulling together. And the interaction that we're seeing across all the different offices, and we've needed to implement a lot, you know, kind of a lot of different ways for people to interact. We used Zoom already as a company, so that was really easy. And we did have a lot of global teams already working together, but then it's bringing other people together that didn't have that global focus in their role, and whether that just be posting photos on our fun channels, or whether that just be, you know, kind of doing the exercise classes that we've put on, or whatever else, we're really seeing that people are coming together and having fun doing it. On the downside, obviously it is a challenge. You know, we've got a lot of parents that are at home with schools closed. They're trying to juggle kids. I know I'm one of those as well. And, you know, trying to focus and, you know, and not have the distractions of, you know, and interruptions of, you know, kind of daily life. It's difficult. And so, and what we're also finding as well is that people are finding it really difficult to shut off from work. Mm-hmm. So in the past, you know, you would leave the office, and whilst there might be some people that might check emails or things out of hours, there weren't a lot of people doing that, whereas now we're having to really make sure that we implement, you know, kind of a lot more education and a lot more guidance to people of really not doing that. Setting a routine, you know, kind of to start your day and setting a routine to end your day. And we're also now at the moment really strongly encouraging people to take some of their leave and vacation, even if they can't go anywhere, because people still need to take a break because we are worried about burnout for some people as well.
Yeah, I think all those really great points. I'm happy to hear it's not too great.
That was quite a long-winded answer then, sorry.
I think another sort of issue on people's minds at the moment is once the offices are able to open again and governments say it's okay, how companies are going to manage that process, because surely we'll have some employees that are nervous to go out in public. Maybe some people like working from home because they don't enjoy commuting or, you know, whatever. What is your plan on how to tackle that situation when it does arise?
I think we're looking at it a little bit differently to some companies that I've spoken to. I think, you know, kind of everyone's going to need to be very flexible as a business in terms of how they do it. But for us, because we can operate completely, you know, remotely, and that our employees, you know, kind of health is our primary concern, not racing back to the office, we'll probably be one of the last ones maybe to go back to the office. We talked yesterday, you know, as a management team, we don't want to be, you know, kind of needing to hand out masks to people and, you know, and monitoring how many people are in the office at any one time and social distancing and all those types of things. For us, there's no, that's not feasible when we can still all be at home. So I think, you know, kind of flexibility definitely needs to be the thing. But for us, we're only going to look to return to any of the offices that we have when it's deemed safe. And once it is safe, then great, you know, kind of then we can go back to the office. And so therefore that, you know, kind of we won't have as much concern, I think, about people that are really scared because we're not going to put them in a situation or anyone in a situation where it's not safe.
Okay, okay. And then for people that prefer working from home, you know, now that you've seen that it can work and you've seen some of the positives and all of this, this is just a topic that's been brought up a lot, so I'm asking you for your perspective.
Absolutely.
What do you think about that?
So, you know, it's interesting. This has been a really good, I guess, test case scenario. But what we've also got to consider is that it's not just a normal test case scenario. At the moment, you know, kind of it is an extreme situation with the pandemic. And so everyone is remote. Everyone's in the same situation. So everyone has to have that flexibility and that mindset, and that's easier to do, I think, than when some people are in an office and some people are remote. And that, I think, is what we're going to see going forward. There will be more people wanting to work remote. And yes, we have proven, you know, kind of that it can work, but I think we need to still think about some of the issues and some of the, you know, kind of concerns that we've had. They're still there, but we just now have a different experience to bring to that. And so we will need to be more flexible going forward, but we still need to think about, you know, kind of how that is going to work, because it's not going to be the same as it has been now. And we can't fall into that trap of just thinking, well, it worked then, why won't it work going forward?
Yeah, I think you make such a good point that this is not a normal situation right now. So we can't really take this and say this is a, yeah, I totally get it. And actually on your panel for iGaming Next Digital, I think it was Pierre brought up a really interesting point that I actually was unaware of. He said that Malta has noticed, well, actually this is pretty, I guess anyone would assume this, that the pollution levels have gone down. I know Malta, everyone loves their car in Malta.
Oh, yes.
Yeah. and to be honest, it's quite hot to be riding your bike and things like that in the summertime. So, but the government is encouraging companies to maybe say, you know, you can have employees working from home, so there's less people driving. What's the situation with that?
I think it's interesting. I think it's great that they're actually thinking about it. But you know, I think, you know, again, as you know, kind of we talked through a little bit in the panel yesterday, it's not the solution.
Yeah.
You know, kind of for the environment. I think it's, you know, kind of a solution, but Malta is such a small country that, you know, where we've had a lot of people in the past in Malta wanting to work from home, you know, we've always given flexibility for when people have deliveries and, you know, whatever else, you know, kind of people can work from home for any of those types of things. But otherwise, if you take a job in Malta, to, you know, kind of why would you want to work from home when, you know, kind of home is only 15, 20 minutes away from the office anyway. That's strange. Whereas I understand, you know, in places like London and Stockholm and larger cities where, yes, you know, kind of that it does make a big difference, and, you know, kind of a lot of people live outside of those cities, you know, for cost reasons and things as well, but then commuting is a major thing, major cost and major time. In Malta, it's not. You know, even if you do take the bus, it's cheap. Yeah. Not, you know, hugely reliable, but cheap. So I think, you know, kind of it's great that they're thinking about it. I don't think it is going to be, you know, the solution for, you know, kind of the environment going forward. But if it is something that then, you know, we do have some more people that do want to work from home a little bit more, and, you know, kind of there are some government benefits to that, then that's great. But it, kind of just reiterating what, you know, kind of Mari and Heidi were talking through, that I think there do need to be other schemes that the government is looking at, and they do need to look at transport on the island entirely, nothing even just to do with the environment, but just in general.
Yeah. As someone who travels to Malta, I know exactly what you're talking about.
Yes.
Well, honestly, I really appreciate and enjoy your practical advice and look at this whole situation. I've always been a big fan of Catena Media. Fiona, thank you very much for sharing with us your plan of attack over there. Wishing you the very best with this situation, and hopefully I get to see you soon in person.
Excellent. Yeah, that'd be great. Thank you, Becky, and no problem at all. I appreciate your time too.
Wonderful. And thank you so much for watching. This is Becky Legiro for calvinair.com.